Mr. Chairman, the witnesses we would like, with your permission, to call at this time are Mr. and Mrs. John B. Conley, who were riding in the limousine with President and Mrs. Kennedy at the time of the assassination. Wounded in the back, chest, wrist, and thigh by rifle fire, Governor Conley was rushed to Parkland Hospital where, though first listed in critical condition, he eventually recovered. Mr. Conley was an administrative assistant to Senator Lyndon B. Johnson, and he served as Secretary of the Navy in the Kennedy administration. He was the governor of Texas from 1963 to 1969, and Secretary of the Treasury in the Nixon administration from 1971 through 1972. He was a special advisor to President Nixon in 1973. He is presently with the Houston law firm of Vinson, Elkins, Searles, Conley, and Smith. Mr. Chairman, it would be appropriate now to call Mr. and Mrs. Conley.
The chair calls Governor and Mrs. Conley.
Governor Conley, on that day in Dallas, was anxious to try to mend political fences, but ironically, Mrs. Jacqueline Kennedy, in her recently taped memories of that day, recalls that President Kennedy was angry at Governor Conley because he said he was trying to thumb his nose at the Democratic Party and get in with all the Republican fat cats. Governor Conley, of course, did change political parties. He's sitting down now. He's been sworn.
Governor and Mrs. Conley, on behalf of the Select Committee on Assassinations, I want to extend to you our most sincere appreciation for your appearance during the beginning of these public hearings. Our mandate from the United States House of Representatives requires this committee to investigate all of the facts and circumstances surrounding the assassination of President John F. Kennedy. As you are well aware, this tragic and shocking event occurred during the President's visit to Dallas, Texas. Indeed, you yourself, Governor Conley, were critically wounded during the barrage of gunfire. The President was visiting the fourth of a five-city visit on an appearance schedule that you were instrumental in planning. The President had come to Texas at your invitation, and you were his official host. Accordingly, to begin our inquiry into this area, we considered it appropriate to request your appearance to give testimony on the facts and circumstances surrounding President Kennedy's decision to visit Texas. Your testimony should cover all of the subsequent events that occurred, as well as the course of preparations and any considerations involved therein. In addition, it will include all decisions leading up to the President appearing in the Dallas motorcade on a route through an area the world has so tragically come to remember as Dealey Plaza, and a building known as the Texas School Book Depository. At this time, I will ask your indulgence in our being excused, and I will at this time ask my distinguished colleague from Connecticut, Mr. Dodd, to assume the chair.
That was Chairman Stokes speaking. As he's indicated, he's going to another congressional hearing to get the money to finish this investigation, to get the authorization for the money. Taking the chair now is Congressman Christopher Dodd of Connecticut, the son of former Senator Thomas Dodd.
At this time, I will ask Mr. Gary Cornwell, who is the Deputy Chief Counsel for the Kennedy investigation, to ask you some questions, Governor and Mrs. Conley, and again, we appreciate your appearance here today. Mr. Cornwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Governor Conley.
I might begin by asking you if it would be accurate to state that you had a leading role in the decision-making process that led to the President's trip to Dallas on November the 22nd, 1963.
Yes, Mr. Cornwell, it certainly would be accurate to say that.
When did the possibility of that trip first become a matter of concern to you?
Well, Mr. Cornwell, I wouldn't characterize it as a matter of concern, but the possibility of a trip to Texas arose, as I recall, in the spring of 1962.
What were you doing during that period of time?
Well, in 1962, I was running for governor of Texas in the midst of a campaign. Vice President Johnson told me then that President Kennedy wanted to come to Texas. He wanted to come to Texas to raise some money, have some fundraising affairs over the state. I was not the least bit interested, very frankly, at that point in time in trying to put together a trip, sponsoring a dinner, for a number of reasons. First, I was in the midst of a primary battle. I was running against an incumbent governor, an incumbent attorney general, and a number of other candidates. The first poll that came out after I announced my candidacy indicated that I had 4% of the votes, so I had an uphill climb in the battle. I fortunately led the primary campaign, but went into a runoff with a young man then, the leader of the liberal element of the Democratic Party in Texas, named Don Yarbrough. I was successful in the runoff and winning the primary runoff, but then was confronted with very, very determined, well-financed, extremely able opposition in the general election. So, frankly, I kept putting off any proposed trip to Texas, again, for a number of reasons. First, every hour, every bit of energy that any of us had was directed toward my own campaign that year. I didn't think that we had the organization. I didn't think we had the time. I didn't think it was the appropriate time to try to bring the president into the state. I didn't think we could do credit to a visit. And so I kept delaying it, notwithstanding the continuous and repeated suggestions from the vice president, who frankly was being needled by the president. The president was making it quite clear to the vice president, Mr. Johnson, that he wanted to come to Texas and he wanted to raise some money in Texas. Well, I can pause there, Mr. Cornwell,
that answers the question. Let me ask you, if you were just beginning to run in the primaries, why was it that the president's desire to have a trip to Texas was brought to your attention? Why was it that you were asked at that point to take part in the trip?
Well, I think first I had known President Kennedy since the early 50s. I had been vice chairman of the Texas delegation to the National Convention in Chicago in 1956 when we supported Mr. Kennedy then, Senator Kennedy, as vice presidential nominee on the national ticket with Mr. Stevenson. I had, as you know, as Mr. Blakey just recounted, I had been appointed by President Kennedy as Secretary of the Navy and had served during the year 1961 as Secretary of the Navy. I had, as a matter of fact, not only talked to Mr. McNamara, but I had gone and talked to President Kennedy before I went home to run for governor. And so I was certainly, at that point, probably the Texans outside of Vice President Johnson, who was closer to the Kennedy administration. And I think it was normal and natural that they would expect me to become involved in it.
Why, at that point in time, did you understand the president wanted to come to Texas?
Well, I think there was never any doubt in my mind about it. There was never any doubt in the president's mind or the vice president's mind. He wanted to come to Texas for two reasons. First, to raise money. Second, to enhance his own political fortunes in Texas. No doubt about it. There was no other reason. Much has been written. Much has been speculated. But I assure you, over many, many months, it was very obvious and very clear that that was the purpose. As a matter of fact, when we, in 1963, after the campaign was over in November of 1962, and I had been successfully elected governor, then I had only 60 days between November and January in order to build a staff and to develop a budget, to develop a legislative program, to submit to the legislature on approximately January the 20th. This was my first legislative session of 120 days, and again, I resisted any proposed presidential trips to Texas because I was totally absorbed and consumed by all of my energies, all of my staff, with a legislative program. It was obvious, though, that as soon as that was over, that we were going to have a trip, and I was perfectly willing at that time to undertake to organize one. But all during this period of time, it was quite clear that the president wanted to come for the purposes for which I've stated, namely to raise money, secondly to enhance his political fortunes in Texas. And I must say that at that point in time, I don't remember the figures exactly, but the president was not extremely popular in Texas, nor was he in the country. He wasn't unpopular. They had had a very bitter campaign in 1960. He'd carried Texas by 46,000 votes, approximately 46,200 some odd votes, with Vice President Johnson on the ticket with him. So it had been an extremely close, extremely hard-fought election. The president had brought great elan, he'd brought great culture, he'd brought great dignity and excitement to the White House. But in spite of that, his legislative program had not fared all that well. He was not all that popular in the country, and his popularity had diminished considerably, as a matter of fact. And he was already looking at 1964 and the campaign of 1964. He'd been traveling all over the country. He made it quite clear that in 1964, if he didn't carry but two states, he wanted to carry Massachusetts and Texas, and he wanted to come to Texas. So it was obvious to me, and again, my reluctance in encouraging the trip, as a matter of fact, it was more than reluctance. I resisted the trip, very frankly. I didn't encourage it. I resisted it for the reasons that I've already explained. During 62, I was involved in the campaigning. The first 120 days of 1963, I was involved in the legislative session. And if he was coming, I wanted him to come to achieve the objectives that he wanted, namely to raise the money, secondly to structure the trip in such a way that he would benefit from it politically.
During this approximately 1 year period from the early part of 1961 through the period in the first part of 62, when, as you described, you were engaged primarily with trying to put together a staff, being a new governor and getting your legislative program through the legislature. The hints continued to come that the president wanted to come to Texas. You continued to stall. Why didn't the president just come on his own?
Oh, he could have. He could have, but he obviously didn't want to. I'd been elected in a rather, I guess it would have to, I'd have to describe it as a surprising election. And I had frankly been elected by the people that President Kennedy needed the most, by the moderates and the conservatives of the state. He obviously had the most liberal wing of the party already for him. They had supported him in 1960 in the campaign. They were still for him. What he was looking for and what he was really chafed about was the fact that the moderate and conservative elements of the country, not just Texas, but the whole country, were not
WXCR Amherst.
Characterized as being anti-business. And part of that was, I think, was the result of his actions with respect to steel prices. But nevertheless, I think this irritated him, and he said so, and he didn't understand it, and he on one occasion said to me that you know, if these business people are silly enough to think that I'm going to dismantle this free enterprise system, they're crazy. And so I think it was obvious
testifying
that he wanted
former
to come
Governor John
on the basis
was in the car and wounded from the day that President Kennedy was shot.
The very people that had not supported him, because he was looking at a tough election, at least in our part of the country, in 1964.
Well, if Then he basically needed someone to help with the planning arrangements to achieve the ends that, that he sought, which was fundraising and improving his political posture in the state. Why didn't he just ask the vice president, who was also from Texas, to arrange those matters for him?
Well, for the simple reason that I had been able to build a pretty successful organization in Texas, and the governor is the titular head of the party of his state, and frankly, the governor of any state, regardless of his party, Republican or Democrat, is the titular head of the party, and he sets the political tone of the state, and it would be inconceivable, and President Kennedy was too good a politician to try to come to Texas without my wholehearted support, or at least tacit approval, and the vice president certainly would not have done it. You know, one of these trips, you know, it's not just as simple as saying, well, let's go to Texas. You know, this requires an incredible amount of planning, organization, detail, harassment, haranguing. We went through weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks of this. So the idea that they're just going to pick up and come, I don't think was attractive to him at all. And it was obvious the president never seriously considered that. He obviously could have come anytime he wanted to. So could the vice president. And the vice president was down during this period of time in 62 and 63. On a number of occasions, but they didn't want to attempt to arrange the type of affair that they were interested in without my personal involvement and without the involvement of the state party machinery that I had constructed.
Did there come a time when you finally couldn't avoid or push back the hints any longer?
Yes, the president I was making a trip out through the West in the summer, I believe, of 1963. He was going to Colorado, New Mexico, and perhaps other states. In any event, he was in El Paso. And I met him in El Paso, and the minute I walked into the room where they were...
What kind of room was it?
The hotel room. I've forgotten, I believe, the Paso del Norte Hotel. The vice president was there. President Kennedy was there, and several of the staff people. Kenny O'Donnell, as I recall, was there. And the president made some remark about, well, Lyndon, when are we ever going to get this trip to Texas worked out? Obviously, he wasn't speaking to me, but he was speaking to me, but he was addressing Vice President Johnson. Vice President Johnson said, well, the governor's here, Mr. President, let's find out. So at that point, my string had run out. I knew that we were going to have a trip to Texas. And I was perfectly willing to do it because I'd gotten through a legislative session in fairly good order, and we had the time. I had been able to rebuild the structure of the Democratic Party, and we were prepared to organize the trip. So I said, in effect, Mr. President, when do you want to come? Well, then he said, I think we ought to have four dinners. And I was in a state of shock. He said, I think we ought to have four or five fundraising dinners. And he said, what do you think about having it on Lyndon's birthday, August the 27th? This was in June, as I recall. And again, I said, well, Mr. President, I'd like to think about that. Obviously the vice president's birthday is always a time for celebration, but August is the worst month of the year to have a fundraising affair in Texas for anybody. I said, too many people are gone. It's the dog days. It's the hottest month of the year. People are on vacations. They're not interested in politics. We can't get the support, and I think it'd be a serious mistake to come in August. Well, we didn't decide at that particular meeting in El Paso when the date would be, but I said, we'll think about it, and I said, in effect, let me do some planning. Let me do some thinking, and we'll be back in touch with you, and I'll suggest a trip, a format of a trip that I think will achieve the purposes that you want to achieve.
Would I understand you, your earlier description of the climate in the state of Texas and in the nation to apply to this period of time, too? I know you described that was basically the way you perceived it when the hints first became came to your attention in 62. I take it they hadn't changed much by 63, is that correct?
No, they had not. I think the president was concerned about the campaign of 1964. His popularity, as your chief counsel, Mr. Blakely, just said, it dropped from 83% down to about 60%. It was and was on a descending scale during this period of time. And I don't remember the precise figures that the polls showed, but obviously he had lost considerable ground, and he was concerned about it.
Well, given that climate in the state of Texas and in the nation, what, if anything, did you expect that you could personally gain or that could be gained for your wing of the Democratic Party from the Texas trip?
Well, I thought first that Texas is always a considerate and a hospitable state to anyone, and most certainly they are to the president. We were obviously going to be honored by a presidential visit to Texas, and we wanted one. The president had really not been to Texas since the campaign of 1960, except for the one stop in El Paso. So he'd not been there for any purpose during the intervening years, and we were obviously all going to benefit by his presence. We were all, at that point, we were Democrats, we were office holders, the fortunes of one obviously affected the fortunes of all, and it was important to all of us that he be understood, that he be accepted, that he be supported as much as we possibly could, and to that extent, I would certainly benefit as an office holder. More than that, President Kennedy's strongest supporters were not my strongest supporters. I had developed a base of support among the moderates and the conservatives in the state, in the Democratic Party, whereas the people that had been most enthusiastic about President Kennedy really had supported my opponent, at least in the primary and in the runoff elections. Most of them supported me in the general election in 1962. So if the president came, and the mere fact that he did come, and my association with him, and the fact that I had helped plan the trip, that I would be with him, that Ms. Connelly and I would be with him, obviously was going to inure to my benefit, it seems to me, among the people who most supported President Kennedy. So there was never any question, really, about my thinking was not that influenced by whether or not I was going to benefit or not benefit. My whole reluctance and resistance up until the summer of 1963 revolved around my fear that we couldn't put on the type of trip that I thought the president deserved and that we wanted him to have.
You told us that at the meeting in El Paso in the hotel suite of the president in June of 1963, you agreed to help him plan the trip, but that no specific agreement was reached as to the details of the trip or as to the date of the trip.
That's correct.
What happened next?
Well, again, Vice President Johnson, with whom I talked frequently during that period of time, told me that the president was still interested in having four or five fundraising dinners. And I said to the vice president, I said, well, that's a mistake. And he said, well, that's what he wants. And you better be prepared to do it, or you better be prepared to give him a real good reason why you can't do it. And I said, all right, I'll work out something and be back in touch with you. I came to Washington in early October of 1963 and went to see the president. Had an appointment before I came up here to see him to talk to him about this dinner. And at that point, he still was talking about four or five fundraising dinners in the principal cities of Texas. And at that point, I just said to him, well, Mr. President, I think that's a mistake. I said, we want the money, yes, but we also need to, it seems to me, to on your first real visit to Texas, we need to posture you in such a way that you're going to politically benefit from it, and it doesn't look like all you're interested in is the money that you're going to get out of the state. And I said, frankly, if you come down and we try to put on five fundraising affairs in the principal cities of Texas, most people down there are going to think that all you're interested in is the financial rape of the state. And I use those words. And he said, well, all right, what do you suggest? And at that point, I said, well, I would suggest, and we've been given a lot of thought to it, I'd talk to the state chairman, I'd talk to members of the legislature, I'd talk to a number of the other political leaders in the state, and I told him that I thought we ought to have a number of non-political events for him to go to, that we ought to try to hit the major cities of Texas, Houston, Dallas, Fort Worth, and San Antonio, and that we ought to culminate it with a dinner in Austin. We didn't go over all the details at this particular visit, but that was a general outline of what I had proposed to him. He said, all right, well, you work it out and get in touch with, as I recall, he said, Kenny O'Donnell, and we'll help work this out, and we'll pick a date. And obviously, we were saying to him that he would have to pick the date of the visit. He and I were in the Oval Office, and he couldn't have been nicer, couldn't have been more friendly. I walked in, he got up from behind his desk, came around, and was extremely warm and cordial, as he always was. He sat in his rocking chair, and I sat on one of those little couches there in the Oval Room, and I frankly was a bit surprised that the Vice President wasn't there. But he wasn't, and I later heard about it. Because after my visit with the president, I went out that evening to the Elms, to the vice president's home, and he was considerably irritated with me, and he said so, and he said, "I suppose you think I don't have any interest in what's happening in Texas." And I said, "No, Mr. Vice President, I know you're extremely interested in what's happening in Texas." He said, "Well, why?" Why didn't you tell me? I said, Mr. Vice President, I assumed you knew I was going to see the president. And he said, trying to alibi the way I could, because I recognized that he was really irritated about it. And I said, after all, I made this appointment several days ago, and I said, it's not my prerogative to say who's in that Oval Office. And I said, I assumed that if the president wanted you there, you'd be there. And well, he said, you could have told me beforehand what you had in mind. And I said, well, you've known basically what I had in mind. I said, in any event, here's what we said. And I recounted to him that I proposed that we visit the five major cities, Dallas, Houston, Fort Worth, San Antonio, culminating in a dinner in Austin. And then I apologized to the vice president. And I said, well, I'm sorry. I should have talked to you before I went in to see the president. But I said, frankly, I assumed you'd be there when I got into the Oval Office, and I was rather surprised that you weren't. And having the appointment, I had no choice but to go ahead and discuss it. And then I said, but here's what we said. So I recounted the conversation as best I could, and we proceeded from there.
Were there any specific discussions with the president on this occasion in early October of 1963 as to the groups are persons that he should meet with in his trip?
Yes, we talked about that, as a matter of fact, as early as El Paso. And I told him that I thought we ought to try to schedule the itinerary and the trip and plan the trip in such a way that he would be, particularly the non-political events, where he could appear before groups, civic groups, basically non-political groups, but groups composed of the moderate to conservative business leaders, political leaders of the state, who had not supported him, who were not enthusiastic about him, in order to try to give him a chance to convert those people. And he agreed with that. No question about that. Now this, you know, as the trip progressed, as they always do, this became quite an issue. Simply because Senator Ralph Yarborough, was then in the Senate, and he was being constantly harangued by his supporters in Texas. They were saying that, well, they're structuring this thing, they're trying to keep us away from the president, and the president's supporters are not getting to see him, and Senator Yarbrough was relaying those to the White House and to the advance people, and we were arguing about tickets, and we were arguing about everything in the world. It got to be a major hassle, and part of this raised the question that has since been discussed at great length, that the president came to Texas to resolve the differences in the Democratic Party in Texas. Nothing could be further from the truth. The two individuals who were most involved in the split in the party were Senator Yarbrough and Vice President Johnson. And both of them were in Washington, D.C. And this is where the trouble was. The trouble arose basically over federal patronage and federal appointees. And Vice President Johnson was trying to get every federal appointment he could get, and so was Senator Yarbrough. Senator Yarbrough was complaining constantly to the White House, to President Kennedy, that Johnson was usurping his patronage rights of the Senate with respect to federal judges, marshals, and so forth. This was the battle here. And indeed, if the president was interested in resolving that difficulty, he had Vice President Johnson right across the street in the old executive office building. He had Senator Yarbrough right here on the Hill, and he could have gotten them together in 10 minutes. But that wasn't the purpose of his trip to Texas at all. It had nothing to do with it. First place, he couldn't settle the differences within the Democratic Party. They haven't been settled yet. And they're not going to be settled. As long as it's basically a one-party state, you're going to have the division there that you have. And you're going to have the liberals and conservatives. They've been fighting all of my adult life. From the time I first went to a convention in Chicago in 1940, National Convention, we had fistfights on the floor within the delegation. And it hadn't improved a lot since then. So the idea that he was going to go down and settle all this is pure hogwash. He didn't intend to do it. He didn't want to do it. He's politician enough to know he couldn't do it. And he wasn't even going to try. That wasn't the point at all. But nevertheless, that created it created difficulties. But these things shouldn't be taken out of context. Any presidential trip anywhere in the world arouses jealousies, differences. Every politician, regardless of his title or position, wants to be close to the president. He wants to ride in the car. He wants to have a private meeting. He wants his group to be seen. He wants them to be heard. This is a constant hassle. I don't care where a president goes. So it's not unique to Texas. But we had our share of it, I'll say that. And this plagued the Kennedy advance people. And it plagued us, and I organized about an 8 or 9 man group, some who worked for me in my own governor's office, others who were in the legislature, others in the state party, to put on this affair. And the president's trip, as I say, it's not easy. The plans were constantly shifting and changing. We were trying to really get a mix of things, and so that people wouldn't feel left out. We had originally planned a one-day trip. And it was obvious that we were trying to cram too much into one day, because again, I wanted to hit the four principal cities plus winding up in Austin. I wanted to see on the evening of the 22nd in Austin the members of the legislature, all of them.
If I might, let me show you an exhibit or two before we get to that explanation. Mr. Chairman, may we admit into evidence at this time an exhibit which has been marked for identification as Exhibit 17, which is a newspaper article from the Dallas Morning News dated September 26, 1963.
Without objection, so ordered.
You've described for us, Governor, the meeting you had with the President on October the 4th. Several days prior to that, the newspaper article, front page of which is shown in the exhibit, appeared in the Dallas Morning News. The headline on the lower right portion of the page refers to the president's visit to Texas, and because the exhibit has blown up, is relatively small. Let me tell you that the first few lines of it read, White House sources told the Dallas News exclusively Wednesday night that President Kennedy will visit Texas November 21st and 22nd. The visit will embrace major cities of the state, including Dallas. Kennedy is currently on a tour of the Midwest and West. The White House sources said the Texas trip would be political, although they did not reveal the particular political mission. Were you aware of either that article or similar publicity prior to your trip to see the president on October the 4th?
Oh, I don't have any specific memory of it, but I'm sure, certainly I knew it.
Do you know, apart from what the implication is in the article, who released that report?
No, but it made no impact on me. I don't have any memory of this particular article at all, but would not be surprising because in the we had made it clear to the president that he was going to have to pick the date for the trip. And I just assumed that that's the date that probably they'd chosen. Man, we were constantly in touch back and forth during this period of time in the fall with the vice president and with Kenny O'Donnell and others trying to plan the type of trip and without getting down to specific details, and we hadn't yet had the date, but I'm sure I knew about this, yes.
You've told us that after the October 4th trip, you went back to Texas and began the process of planning for the trip. Who all was involved in that process?
Oh, gosh, a great many people. Everyone in my office was. My executive assistant, Howard Rose, certainly was. Eugene Locke, who I believe was still chairman of the, from Dallas, who was still chairman of the State Democratic Party, was. Pat O'Keefe, who was executive director of the state party, was involved. Carol Abbott, who worked at the state party, was certainly involved. Bill Stinson, who was on my governor's staff, certainly was involved. Representative Ben Barnes was involved. Frank Irwin was involved. Julian Reed was involved. There were 8 or 10 of us who spent a great deal of time on it.
Let me ask Mrs. Connelly, were you involved in that process too?
Yes, I certainly was.
What was your role?
I was shining that mansion up like you never saw. We were trying to get everything ready at the governor's mansion for our first visit from a president and his lady. So I had all the hassles of any housewife trying to get her house in order so it would be just right for the very special guest.
I think to put it in a little different context, I think the first thing we agreed on, and Nellie certainly was involved in intimate detail with the trip, because the one thing we'd agreed on, we were going to try to wind up with the fundraising affair in Austin, Texas. Now, because of the nature of the state, unless you do have 4 or 5 fundraising affairs, you cannot choose another city in Texas and have as successful a fundraising dinner as you can if you have it in Austin. Dallas doesn't want to support Houston. Houston doesn't want to go to Dallas. Dallas won't go to Fort Worth. Fort Worth don't want to go to Dallas. None of them will go to San Antonio. But all of them will go to Austin. So we decided that it was the capital, that what the president needed to do was to come to Austin. This was the news center of the state, just like Washington is for the nation. All the news media were there. We wanted him to meet the members of the legislature because they, in effect, were the thought leaders, the political thought leaders of the Democratic Party throughout the state. And we thought that this would be like any politician. Any politician wants to know the President of the United States. He wants to say, I know him. I shook his hand. Yeah, I saw him. He wants to go home and tell his constituents that he saw him. So we'd planned the one thing we had done, which we had to agree on early, was to have the dinner in Austin. $100 a plate affair, because we had to start selling tickets. Then we, Nellie and I agreed that probably the best place for a reception was to ask the President and Ms. Kennedy to come to the mansion and invite the entire legislature, 150 members of the House, 31 members of the Senate, to come to the mansion to meet the President. And at that time, we weren't sure Ms. Kennedy was coming. In my visit with him, I had expressed the hope that she would come. And he said, well, I'm not sure, but I will talk to her about it, and I will ask her to come with me. And as I recall, he said at the time I saw him, I believe he said she was in Europe. And he said, when she gets back, I'll ask her and if she won't come with me. I told him that I thought that in all of these events, there were going to be men and women, that I thought they would contribute enormously if she came. That the women wanted to see her. They'd read a great deal about her. And I said, frankly, they want to see what her hairdo looks like and what her clothes look like. And I said, it's just important to them. So he said, I agree with you, and I'll talk to her about it when she gets back. So in any event, we thought if we could have the president and Ms. Kennedy at the mansion to meet all the members of the state party machinery, the representatives and the senators, it would probably be as effective a thing as we could do to help him on his trip. And then from there, we'd go directly to the dinner at the Coliseum, where we planned to have 3,000 people at $100 a plate.
What were the other basic elements in your initial proposal to the president as to how the trip should be organized?
Well, basically, that we had to get a non-political sponsorship and a non-political activity in the four other major cities to give him a forum to attract the type of audience, to give him some identity. And as I recall, early on, we in Fort Worth, we considered the idea of having Texas Christian University in Fort Worth confer an honorary degree on him and let him speak on the campus of Texas Christian University. That was thought of early. In Houston, he really came up, I think, or the White House did, with the idea of going to the Albert Thomas dinner. And this helped us because we were trying to cram everything into the day of the 22nd on Friday. Well, just before the trip, as I recall, we didn't have but about 48 hours notice, not more than 72, he decided he would go to Houston. So we restructured the whole thing. I had planned to or had suggested that we go to San Antonio, Houston, Fort Worth, Dallas, and Austin all in one day. But then the Albert Thomas dinner. Albert Thomas was then chairman of the Appropriations Committee of the House of Representatives. He was one of the really powerful members of the Texas delegation. He'd been chairman of the Appropriations Committee since 1940. And he was extremely well regarded in Houston, Texas. He was one of the strange, not strange, he was one of the unusual and unique politicians. Albert Thomas had the support of all the business community in Houston. He also had all the support of labor and most of the liberals in Houston. And they were having, he was sick. He had a terminal illness. And they were having this appreciation dinner for him the night of the 21st of November. And the president decided that he ought to go there and be there. And obviously Albert Thomas really wanted him to come and really put the arm on him to come. And no president in his right mind completely disregards the chairman of the Appropriations Committee. And since he was ill and since they were good friends, the president, I think, graciously said, I'd like to come. So this changed our whole format. Then we were able to get him for a day and a half. So we moved the San Antonio affair to Thursday afternoon. We decided to go on to Fort Worth that night, the night of the 21st, after the Albert Thomas dinner in Houston. In the meantime, in trying to work out the itinerary and talking about an honorary degree from Texas Christian University, frankly, some of the trustees of Texas Christian University took a dim view of it and weren't enthusiastic about it, and we dropped the idea completely, because the last thing we wanted to do was get in any kind of a dispute or a hassle, because we wanted his trip to be smooth. We wanted it to be everything acceptable. I personally went to Dallas. I talked to the leaders of all the civic groups in Dallas, the Citizens Council, which is a group that had for 40 years dominated the political leadership of Dallas. We got the Assembly, which is a group of young people. We got the Educational Research Center, or Science Research Center. We got four or five groups in Dallas to co-sponsor this luncheon. Again, to give it a non-political flavor so that he could go and make a speech. We'd done that in each of the places. The White House itself came up with the idea, or somebody did, that they would dedicate the Aerospace Medical Center in San Antonio. And it was a non-political affair. The breakfast in Fort Worth was a non-political affair. It was also sponsored by the Chamber of Commerce and other organizations. But in working it all out, we had a motorcade in San Antonio. You know, again, over the period of time, because the great tragedy occurred in Dallas, everybody talks about the president's trip to Dallas. The president made a trip to Texas. And we'd been to San Antonio, where we met the president. We had a motorcade through San Antonio. And again, this was an effort to be sure that he wasn't shielded from anybody, that he was out seeing people. We had a motorcade right through the center of San Antonio. The reception was wonderful. The crowds were huge. The response was enthusiastic. We went from there. We spent about 30 minutes or 45 minutes at the Aerospace Medical Center. And he dedicated that building, and it's on the side of the old Brooks Army Air Force Base. We left San Antonio, went to Houston, arriving there about 5 o'clock. And we planned this simply because, again, we wanted every detail of the trip to be as perfect as we could make it.
Your basic plan of meeting with the various citizens groups and the representatives of the business community, did that meet any stiff resistance, and if so, from what area?
No, I don't think it met any stiff resistance. I think the complaints came, as I said a moment ago, from largely voiced by Senator Yarber and some of the labor groups and some of the liberal groups on the grounds that not enough of their people were being included. Now, the leadership and labor and among the blacks and everybody else, they were being included in these affairs. They were, even though they weren't formally members of these organizations, they were being invited, they were being given tickets, but they weren't being invited in mass numbers to the various affairs. But they were there at the breakfast. They were there at the Albert Thomas dinner. They were there at the luncheon at the Trade Mart in Dallas. They certainly were there at the affair, or to be there at the affair in Austin that night, the $100 plate dinner. Matter of fact, we sent all of them tickets. We said, please help us.
Who did the conversations occur with where there were disagreements as to at least the emphasis that should be placed on various aspects?
Very few of them with me. I was meeting intermittently with these 8 or 9 people that I had working on this trip. But
who were your people meeting with, though?
They were meeting with Hal Bruno, the president's advance man. We were getting information from all kind of sources. We were getting direct calls from the top labor leaders in the state and others. You know, we were getting a considerable feedback and frankly, a considerable differences developed between the president's advance men and the people I had working on the trip. And to the point where it got a bit testy.
What were the main areas of disagreement?
Oh, just minutia, details. You know, inevitably these things happen about who's going to sit at the table, who's going to do this, who's going to do that. One of the biggest controversies arose whether or not we were going to have a motorcade in Dallas. That was one of the big ones. And we lost that one. And finally, frankly, it got so bad that with Hal Bruno and the president's advance people that differences developed between the people I had working on the trip and the president's advance people. For Hal Bruno, I think, was pulled off completely off of the trip, and Bill Moyers came down as kind of a peacemaker.
What was your view in opposing the motorcade in Dallas? You said there was a severe disagreement with the advance men on that subject.
Basically, my reasons for opposing the motorcade in Dallas were two. We were working the president very hard, I thought. Most people think that riding in a motorcade is easy. It's not. It's very tiring. It's exhausting. You assume that a person just riding along, so it shouldn't be any difficulty. But nevertheless, in a motorcade, the president of the United States is there. He's tense. He's smiling. He's exuding enthusiasm. He's trying to make, even in a fleeting second, he's trying to make contact with the thousands and tens of thousands of people that are along this parade route. And he's looking one side and then the other. And even if he just catches a human's eye for one fleeting second, There's a communication. And this is why in the car, Nellie and I had very little conversation with President Ms. Kennedy. The conversations were extremely brief and desultory because he was, in effect, working the crowd from the car. And to a lesser extent, so was I. And it's you have to be in one. You have to experience it to understand precisely what I'm saying. But I'm telling you that it's a strain on him. Well, we had him getting up early in the morning to attend a breakfast in Fort Worth. He made a speech on the parking lot in front of the Texas Hotel in Fort Worth. Then we flew to Dallas. He had a speech there. We were going to take him to Austin, where he had two receptions at the mansion for 181 members of the House and Senate. Then he had a speech that night. We were crowding him into about a 15-hour day, and what I wanted him to do, you know, you can work anybody to death. Ask any of these members of this committee, and they'll tell you when they go into a town or a county, the local campaign chairman, or into a precinct or a ward, he wants to work him from 7 in the morning till midnight. He don't care what happens tomorrow because he's going to be gone. This local politician, he'll go to sleep. He'll sleep all the next day. But unfortunately, the office holder has to get up and go again on another 15-hour day. And I was extremely conscious of that because I'd managed, I started in state politics in 1938. I'd managed President Johnson's campaign in 1941 and in 1948 when he ran for the Senate. And I'd been through enough of this. I'd caught enough hell about overscheduling. And so I didn't want to do the president that way. And I wanted him to be sharp. And you know, no human being can be up for 15 hours in the day. And all we were trying to do was allow him enough time in between events to where when he really got in front of an audience, when the cameras were on him, when the newsmen were watching him, that he could look good, he would look fresh, his voice would be strong, he could really be able to exude warmth and enthusiasm, and this is the whole reason. Now, there was one other reason, and that was simply that I thought, no more so really than Dallas, I guess, than most places in Texas, but I thought that we ran the risk of having some embarrassing placards or signs or a few pickets along the way, and I frankly never had any fear of physical harm or violence. That never entered my mind. But the idea that we probably would encounter a sign or two did enter my mind. And the thought that we might have some pickets entered my mind. Because, again, President Johnson and Ms. Johnson had the difficulty down in front of the Baker Hotel in the campaign in 1960. Then, as you recounted a moment ago, Ambassador Stevenson, Adlai Stevenson, came to Texas and had been hit over the head with a picket sign about a month before the president's trip. So these things were not, I was not unconscious of them at the time, and we didn't want any of it. Well, the only thing we saw in any of the trips, Dallas did have one sign. It was fell up on an old house. Looked like a turn-of-the-century house, badly needing paint, I recall very well. And he had a sign up on this balcony. It said, "Kennedy, go home." Well, it was on the left side of the car as we were traveling in the motorcade, and the president was on the right side in the back seat, and I hoped he didn't see it, but he finally turned to Nellie and me and said, "Did y'all see that sign?" I said, "Yes, Mr. President, we were hoping you didn't." He said, "Oh, I saw it." He said, "Don't you imagine he's a nice fellow?" And I said, "Yeah, I imagine he's a nice fellow." But that was about the only thing that we saw. But and frankly, there was less of that than I thought. The crowds were larger than I anticipated. They were more enthusiastic than I could have even hoped for. All the way through, in San Antonio, in Houston, in Fort Worth, it was drizzling rain at 8:30 in the morning when the president went out, approximately 8:30, when he went out on a parking lot there across from the Texas Hotel and spoke to people in the rain. And there was a huge crowd there. So the trip had been absolutely wonderful. And we were heaving a sigh of relief because once we got through the motorcade in Dallas and through the Dallas luncheon, then everything else was pretty much routine.
Let me ask you to go through the details of that trip, perhaps more precisely. After the elaborate planning and the arguments over the details, I suppose there must have been some relief the day finally came.
Oh, yes.
Let me ask, Mrs. Connolly, you had an opportunity to meet the president and his wife at the airport, is that correct?
Yes.
Where did you come from just immediately prior to that?
I came from Austin to San Antonio.
What had you been doing in the immediate hours or day or two right before the arrival?
Well, I had the entrance hall in the governor's mansion had a gold, sort of gold carpet. And since this house is open to the public, it gets a lot of traffic. So I had had the carpet cleaned. But 2 days before the visit, I decided they didn't clean it well enough, and I was having it cleaned again. So I was having a talk with the carpet cleaners, and I left the house in Austin and joined them in San Antonio.
The governor, as I understand, was in Houston that day and had to fly to San Antonio to meet the president's plane. So
yes.
You were both arrived in advance and were together, is that correct?
From different directions.
Would you describe for us what your feelings were as the event took place and the president arrived into Texas for the first time?
Me?
Yes, ma'am.
It was very exciting. It was the first time that we had been host to a president and his lady, and everybody was excited. We were excited and nervous and wanted, I tell you, I felt exactly like the mother of everybody. I wanted all the Texans to be so wonderful to them when they came, and I wanted them to react in a good way too, and I just was nervous and excited and could hardly wait.
Were the reactions from the people in Texas as you had hoped?
There was a tremendous roar when the plane put down and the door opened and out stepped Ms. Kennedy, who looked beautiful just like everybody expected, and then the handsome young president coming out behind her. I get goose pimples now thinking about it. It really was an exciting moment in our life.
You went from the airport in a motorcade to downtown San Antonio.
Yes.
Was the reception there as great?
Oh, yes. Yes, tell them about the reception, Don. Everybody was excited. It just made you feel good.
Yeah, you couldn't have asked for more. The crowds were large, they were extremely warm, extremely enthusiastic. Just could not have been better.
Did the activities in San Antonio and for the rest of that day go just as well? Was there anything about them which was disappointing?
Nothing that I know.
No, it all went extremely well. We left San Antonio and went to Houston, got in Houston right at the, and there were several thousand people at the airport to meet us, and we went downtown right at the rush hour traffic. Of course, the cars were bumper to bumper, almost four lanes wide, and they all stopped for just miles as this they were leaving town. We were going into town, and as this motorcade passed, people were out, they were stopped, they were standing up, the car doors open, they were all waving and
cheering.
And
really?
We got to the hotel. The president met that evening with a group of Mexican-American leaders. The LULAC organization was having a big dance in the Rice Hotel where they were staying, and he and Ms. Kennedy, Vice President Ms. Johnson, went by there before they went to the Thomas Dinner. The Thomas Dinner was a complete sellout in the Coliseum. I guess they had 3,500 people there. And I watched because I knew these people and I knew the crowd. And frankly, I don't remember what the president said. I must confess I didn't listen to him because I was concentrating almost totally on the crowd reaction. I was looking and watching all through the crowd during his entire speech, and he was indeed reaching these people. He was communicating with them. And it just could not have been a better day in both San Antonio and Houston.
After the Albert Thomas dinner and the meeting with the Mexican-American leaders had concluded, you flew again in Air Force One, this time to Fort Worth. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Up until this point of the trip, had you had any opportunity really to speak to the president and to learn what his reaction was to the reception he had received in Texas?
Yes, don't you remember how excited he was about how everything worked?
They talked in the airplane when you flew from San Antonio to Houston. And the president seemed very pleased with how he'd been received in San Antonio and said, well, that was a good one, John. Do you think we'll do as well at the next stop?
You know, he's a... Unlike, I suppose, the often repeated verbosity of some of us from Texas, the president was not given to extravagant statements, and he was, I think he had the terse, generally was known for the fairly terse comments of a New Englander and a Bostonian. So his praise would be couched in different language, what my own, but it was obvious he was extremely pleased. And I think Nellie probably can explain this better than I, but I think the one of the significant things that occurred was the change that we saw in Miss Kennedy and her reaction to the trip. In San Antonio, she was rather stiff, I thought, rather unused to this. She'd not been traveling much and campaigning much with the president, and she was not noticeably ill at ease at all, but nevertheless reserved, quiet, and perhaps a little bit frightened is too strong a word, but apprehensive about, you know, about this whole thing, and not apprehensive in the sense of being fearful of violence, but just not being used to it. She was a bit concerned about what she did. For instance, one time in San Antonio, she was worried about her hair and her hat, and she traded seats with me. We were all over that car. Normally the president sits in the right rear and his wife sits on his left. I was sitting in front of the president most of the time. Nellie was sitting in front of Miss Kennedy most of the time. But particularly in San Antonio, we changed seats. And because the wind was blowing, we were driving fairly fast at times, 30 and 40 miles an hour, she traded seats and got up on the jump seat. I sat in the back seat with the president. Two ladies were in front. Then
the back seat was raised, so she'd get more wind there.
But the president knew that really wasn't the right way to do it, and he made her get back in the back seat. And I got back on the jump seat. And
where
I belong. The next day, it was obvious that after the San Antonio and the Houston motorcades, the next day she was much, much more relaxed, wouldn't you say?
Yes, happily responding to the crowd.
Marked difference in her reactions and her appearance between the afternoon of the 21st and the day of the 22nd, noticeably in Dallas.
And they were enjoying seeing her as much as they were the president. They were calling out their names, and I think she really got in the spirit of it.
You've told us about the dispute, which was long-standing, between Senator Yarborough and First Senator Johnson, and then continuing into Vice President Johnson. Did that particular dispute come up at all? You said that it wasn't the reason the president came to Texas. Did it come up at all during the trip?
Yes. Oh, it was ever with us. It came up. I didn't know it. Everything had gone beautifully. We got into Fort Worth about 11 o'clock at night at Carswell Air Force Base and drove into town in a light drizzle. And the president, Ms. Kennedy, and Vice President Ms. Johnson went up to their suites, and when they were safely ensconced, I was so relieved and that everything had gone well that I went down to the Texas Hotel coffee shop to have some bacon and eggs and a glass of milk about midnight, and that was the first then I heard that they'd had quite a hassle in Houston, that Senator Yarborough had refused to ride in the car with Vice President Johnson. So I said, well, you know, I don't care who rides in which car. I didn't worry much about it. But nevertheless, it had happened. And it was by that time the talk of the motorcade, talk of the press, and so I didn't think any more about it till the next morning. And the president, when he came back from from his speech, the first thing he did when he got up, Miss Kennedy was not with him, Jim Wright, Congressman Jim Wright, who's now the majority leader of this Congress, of the House, took him across the street from the Texas Hotel into this parking lot, where he spoke to the crowds there, and then he came back into the Longhorn room of the Texas Hotel and sat down, and he motioned for me to come over, and I went over there, and he said, John, did you know Yarber refused to ride with Lyndon yesterday? I said, yes, sir, I heard that last night. And he said, by God, he'll ride with him today or he'll walk. And I said, okay. And I did nothing about it. But he apparently, then later, I saw him talking to Senator Yarber, and indeed, that day, Senator Yarber rode in the car with Vice President Johnson in the Dallas motorcade. So, this is one of those things that's really in the overall planning and the execution of this trip was of no great consequence.
So that was the only part of what we might call the Yarborough-Johnson feud that was even taken up by the president on the trip. Is that correct?
Right.
Let me then direct
well, your... In deference to my old hometown of Fort Worth, Mr. Cornwell, and also to set the record straight, at least one publication talked about the... in Fort Worth, the drab, sordid hotel room, the presidential suite in which the president stayed. Well, it turned out that it so happened that the Texas Hotel was at that point controlled by the Eamon Carter estate and Sid W. Richardson estate, and they had gone to great pains to do everything they could once it was certain he was coming to Fort Worth, going to stay at the Texas Hotel, to refurbish this suite. And matter of fact, Ms. J. Lee Johnson III, Ms. Ruth Carter Johnson, Ms. Damon Carter's daughter, had gone to the trouble to go to private homes around town and had borrowed paintings. And Nellie helped me, but there was a Picasso in the suite. There was a Monet in the suite. Then Van Gogh in the suite, and two or three more. So they probably had a couple of $1 million worth of paintings just on the walls. And I assure you, they'd done everything they could. The president was obviously impressed, and so was Miss Kennedy. He first thing he did the next morning was to call Miss Johnson, Miss J. Lee Johnson III, who lived in Fort Worth, and thank her for her kindness and for her trouble and for her consideration, and to tell her how delighted they were with the accommodations in the hotel, all of which means nothing except to kind of clear the air and set the record straight, because things get told and then they get repeated, and I think in all fairness we ought not to describe that suite as a rundown, sordid suite.
Makes me mad.
The next morning, the one you've just been describing, of course, was November the 22nd, 1963. The president had a breakfast and then a meeting with the Chamber of Commerce scheduled.
What?
A breakfast scheduled,
yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
And thereafter he had a speech in the parking lot, is that correct?
No, I think he really spoke...
In the parking lot.
I believe he spoke in the parking lot first. Okay. And then he came back into the hotel, and then Miss Kennedy joined him. She did not go across the street to the parking lot, but she did join him, and then they came into the breakfast together. I would guess this is now 9:25, 9:30, something like that.
He came in first and
made
the statement that that Jackie was pulling herself together, and then turned to Vice President Johnson and said, Lyndon, nobody pays any attention to what we wear. Which I thought was funny, didn't you?
The morning then, I take it, started off well, is that correct?
Extremely well.
The weather was somewhat drizzly, but apart from that, the schedule went well. The receptions again were as you described them on the previous day, is that
accurate? And there were 2,500 people in that breakfast that morning. So, you know, the idea that he was just meeting with a few exclusive hand-picked people is hardly true. There were that breakfast meeting alone had, I think, 2,500 people there.
Thereafter, you all again boarded Air Force One and flew to Dallas.
Sure.
You've told us previously what types of concerns you had had about the motorcade in Dallas, the incident with Adlai Stevenson. Was there anything else that you can recall as far as that went through your mind during that period of time as you were approaching Dallas and preparing to enter the motorcade?
No, not really. There'd been an ad, and I've forgotten what it said, in the paper, the morning paper that morning, about the trip that was a somewhat derogatory ad. But I really was not apprehensive about anything, except, as I said, that we might see an embarrassing sign or some rude statement or a few pickets here or there. But I must say, as Air Force One landed at the airport in Dallas, the sun broke through. It was absolutely marvelous weather. Could not have been better. And the crowd at the airport was several thousand people. It was, again, an extremely receptive group of people who were out there, enthusiastic group of people. I recall that after President Ms. Kennedy shook hands with those in the receiving line, they went over, and the Vice President, Ms. Johnson, accompanied them, and they went over and for 5 minutes or so walked up and down the fence where there were thousands of people gathered and shaking hands and greeting people who'd come to the airport to see them.
Tell us then, if you would, in more detail, what happened as you all entered the limousine and began the motorcade.
Well, we immediately, as these things are normally done, it was timed fairly well, and we immediately got in the cars, the motorcade started. One thing I do recall, I said a moment ago that Ms. Kennedy appeared to be much more relaxed, much more in the spirit of things. She was smiling more, obviously more at ease. But one little thing, the sun was bright. It had come out bright and beautiful. The sky was beautiful. The clouds had dispersed. And she put on her dark glasses. And what did he say? Said,
"Take your glasses off, Jackie."
Yeah. "Take your glasses off, Jackie." And she kept them off for a while, and she just unconsciously put them back on.
You'd hear him again say, "Take your glasses off, Jackie."
And this happened a third time. And then I think she finally left them off. But on the way down in the motorcade, again, the crowds were large. The crowds were enthusiastic. We stopped two or three times. I remember twice, in particular, there was a little girl, I guess she was 8 years old, who had a placard and said, "President Kennedy," was something like, will you shake hands with me?" And held up this sign. Well, he immediately stopped the car and shook hands with this little girl. And, of course, the car was mobbed. Well, the minute the car stopped, here came the Secret Service, and they got between the car, the limousine, in which he was riding, and the mass of people who immediately surrounded the car, and we extricated ourselves from this group and then went on. The other stop,
WFCR Amherst.
We were about halfway downtown, I suppose, when there was a nun, a sister, with a bunch of school children, obviously from a parochial school there, right by the car, and he stopped and said, spoke to them and to the sister and to the children. We stopped a third time, I believe, along the route. But
what was the route, incidentally? Would you describe that for us? How did the motorcade go from the airport to its destination site, which was the trademark?
I think we went down Lemon Avenue
to Turtle Creek,
and from Turtle Creek to Maine, and from Maine to Houston to Elm, I believe.
So at least the idea was it was basically a route which took you down through the heart of downtown Dallas.
Right through the heart of Dallas. Yeah, no question about it. And as the further we got toward town, the denser became the crowds. And when we got into down on Main Street, the crowds were extremely thick. They were pushed off of the curbs. They were out in the street. And they were backed all the way up against the walls of the buildings. They were just as thick as they could be. There were, I don't know how many, but there were at least 250,000 people on that parade route that day. And everywhere the reception was good. I told you a moment ago about the only sign that we saw that was in the least bit unpleasant.
Mrs. Connolly, at any point in the motorcade, did you have a chance to speak to the president?
Yes, we were having such a wonderful reception, and we were all so excited, and we had had through all these other cities, and I had restrained myself up to that point from saying anything, but I could no longer stand it. So I turned around to the president, and I said, Mr. President, you can't say Dallas doesn't love you.
And where was that in the motorcade? At what point?
That was just as we were right approaching the book depository.
Just before we turned.
Just before we turned.
Mr. Chairman, at this time, I think I might suggest to you that we could take a brief break and set up a projector and now show a film of the motorcade.
Order. Order. At this time, we'll take a brief break to set up the film portion.
Well, while we are taking the brief break to set up the film, we'll talk a little bit about what we've heard so far this morning and sort of compare notes about what history says about what happened that morning. As I started to say earlier, Jackie Kennedy has recently taped an oral history for the Lyndon Johnson Library of her memories of that day. And she said in that tape, or the reports of that tape, President Kennedy was quite angry with Governor Conway because he felt he was thumbing his nose at the White House and saying, in effect, I've got all the support I want here from the Republican fat cat, and I don't need you. And as I noted, Governor Conway eventually changed parties and served in the Nixon cabinet, and later was acquitted of bribery charges, and he is now considered one of the potential candidates on the Republican ticket to run for president. Bob Jackson of the Los Angeles Times is with me. We've heard sort of an extended commentary about local Texas politics this morning. I don't suppose that really has very much to do with the Kennedy assassination, but it puts that fateful morning in some perspective.
I think the committee is trying to set the stage, set the atmosphere for the testimony that is about to come and the analysis that we'll come up with from committee experts tomorrow of the ballistics test. And this was more or less of a long a living room type of reminiscence by former Governor John Conway and his wife as to what the whole trip was like, the planning that went into it, and it was a very informal, chatty discourse by the Conleys as to all the planning that went into the trip, what the purpose of it was.
The one thing you got some insight into is what a politician really thinks about. You know, that when you're in a motorcade, you don't talk, you work the crowd with your eyes.
Well, that's right, and Governor Connally noted that he himself had opposed the motorcade in Dallas on the theory that, as he said, we were working the president very hard. That is, the day earlier when the president had visited Houston and San Antonio, which is a part of the Kennedy trip to Texas that few of us even remember now, because Dallas has so overshadowed his visits the day before to these other cities where he got a very warm and enthusiastic response. Governor Conway said that he felt that the motorcade in Dallas would have been overly tiring and exhausting for the president, because the president in a motorcade of this type likes to make eye contact with thousands of people along the route, working the crowd, so to speak, from the automobile. And this was not a time, as you said, when you indulge in conversation with a president who is standing in the car working the crowd. His comments that he had opposed the motorcade had a historic, very ironic note, because, of course, if the motorcade had not occurred, the course of history would have been drastically altered in this country.
One thing that we'll be looking for in this film, the controversy surrounding the bullets fired into the body of President Kennedy involved a number of items. Perhaps the largest controversy involves how many shots were fired. The Warren Commission concluded that 3 shots were fired, one of which went into his, came out of his throat, one of which blew his head off, and the one that went into his back and out of his throat went into the body of John Connally. Connally has said he believed there were more bullets than that. Now, if in fact there were more bullets than that, a single human being cannot have fired 4 bullets in the space of time that we know they had to be fired from that kind of a gun. So we'll be looking at the film in view of that, and also the positioning, where the bullets seem to come from. The room is now darkened, and Professor Blakey has now been recognized to narrate the film.
I would note initially that this is a copyrighted film. November the 22nd, 1963, 11:40 a.m. Central Standard Time, President and Mrs. Kennedy arrive at Love Field, Dallas, on Air Force One, after a brief flight from Fort Worth. It is a bright, sunshiny day, though it had been raining earlier. The President and First Lady greet well-wishers at Love Field. Then they join Governor John B. Connally of Texas and his wife, Nellie. Kennedys and Connallys get into the open presidential limousine for the trip into the city. Plans to have the presidential party enclosed in the limousine's bubble top were abandoned when the rain stopped. There's no need for top coats or hats. The temperature is 68 degrees. Destination? The International Trademark, where the President is to deliver a luncheon address to an audience of businessmen. This is the last leg of the swing through Texas. Yesterday, the presidential party visited San Antonio and Houston. Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson is riding in the limousine behind the President, along with Texas Senator Ralph Yarborough. The motorcade left Love Field shortly after 11:50 a.m., the crowds that line the route get thicker as it reaches the business district of the city. Main Street. The motorcade is approaching Dealey Plaza, an area where open lawns are surrounded by express highways and tall buildings. At the corner of Main and Houston, the motorcade makes a sharp 90-degree turn to the right and heads north for 1 block. The Texas School Depository is directly in front of the presidential limousine. The book depository isn't shown. It's located to the immediate left of the picture. As the limousine approaches the intersection of Houston and Elm Streets, Mrs. Connally, as she indicated, elated by the reception, says, "Mr. President, you can't say Dallas doesn't love you." The President replies, "That's obvious." At Elm Street, the limousine makes a hairpin turn to the left and heads west, passing the book depository. The picture shows police motorcycles leading the limousine as it goes by the depository. The building in the background is the book depository. The window at the extreme right of the top of the picture is the one where earlier investigations have concluded Lee Harvey Oswald is located at this moment. It's about 12:30 p.m. As the President waves to the crowd, shots ring out. The President and Governor Connally are wounded. president is struck in the head. The limousine speeds up, heading for the Simmons Freeway. Its destination is now Parkland Memorial Hospital. At approximately 1 p.m., the president will be pronounced dead.
Can we have the lights back, please?
That was a film of President Kennedy's assassination.
Counsel for the committee.
Mr. Cornwall, counsel for the committee, will now continue the questioning of Governor and Mrs. Connolly.
At this point, Mrs. Connolly, I'd like to ask you some questions about what your memory is of what happened on Elm Street after the limousine passed underneath the Texas School Book Depository. What distance after turning the corner do you recall the car going before you noticed something was wrong?
Not very far. I don't really know how far. Do you want me to just tell you everything I remember?
That would be fine.
I heard, you know how we were seated in the car, the president and Mrs. Kennedy, and John was in front of the president, and I was seated in front of Mrs. Kennedy. I heard a noise that I didn't think of as a gunshot. I just heard a disturbing noise and turned to my right from where I thought the noise had come and looked in the back and saw the president clutch his neck with both hands. He said nothing. He just sort of slumped down in the seat. John had turned to his right also when we heard that first noise and shouted, "No, no, no," and in the process of turning back around so that he could look back and see the president, I don't think he could see him when he turned to his right, the second shot was fired and hit him. He was in the process of turning, so it hit him through this shoulder, came out right about here. His hand was either right in front of him or on his knee as he turned to look, so that the bullet went through him, crushed his wrist, and lodged in his leg. Now, all I knew was, and then he just recoiled and just sort of slumped in his seat, and I thought he was dead. When you see a big man totally defenseless like that, then you do whatever you think you can do to help most. And the only thing I could think of to do was to pull him down out of the line of fire or whatever was happening to us. And I thought if I could get him down, maybe they wouldn't hurt him anymore. And so I pulled him down in my lap. We learned later, I read a lot of stories that upset me later because they said that we slipped down into the floor, that John slid off fell over into my lap. Those little jump seats were not very, very big, and there was no way that he could have slid to the floor. There's no way that either of us could have got to the floor. So the only thing that I could do was pull him down, and by leaning over him, I hoped if anything else happened, they wouldn't hurt him anymore. I never looked back after John was hit. I heard Miss Kennedy say they have shot my husband. Then I heard a third shot and felt matter cover us. And she said, "They killed my husband. I have his brains in my hand." I thought John was dead, and I heard the Secret Service man say, "Let's get out of here quick." And so we pulled out of the motorcade, and we must have been a horrible sight flying down that freeway with these dying men in our arms and going to no telling where. We could just see the crowd flashing by. John said nothing. I said only to him from the time I saw one little movement that made me think he is still alive. Then I kept whispering to him, be still. It's going to be all right. Be still. It's going to be all right. I've read stories where I screamed and he screamed and all these things, and there was no screaming in that horrible car. It was just a silent, terrible drive. We got to the hospital. Yes, it was the hospital. The car stopped, and John was still in my lap, but I knew he was alive, and people were swarming all around the car, and they were trying to get Miss Kennedy to get out so they could get the president out, and she didn't seem to want to get out of the car. And I sat there for what seemed to me an awfully long time, but probably was just a few minutes, wondering how long I had to sit there with this man dying in my arms before I could ask somebody to do something. And at about that moment, John just sort of heaved himself up out of my arms and then just kind of collapsed in front of the door. And at that moment, the door opened and somebody picked him up and just ran off down the corridor, and I ran along behind him. We got into what later I found was the trauma room one and trauma room two. The president was on a stretcher right behind us, I guess. I still had never looked back. And John was in the room on the right, and as we approached, the president was on the right and John was on the left, and I stood there. So alone. I never have felt so alone in my life. And there was much commotion racing all around us. I saw all sorts of artillery and weapons, and I assume it was the Secret Service or security, I don't know, racing up and down around the corridor. Finally, somebody brought two chairs and sat them outside these two doors, and I sat in one, and Miss Kennedy sat in the other. I kept seeing all this commotion in the president's room, and I wondered if I knew the president was dead, but I wondered if they weren't all over there and nobody taking care of John. And the only thing that would calm me a little was I'd get up every now and then and just push open the door in the room where he was, and if I could see any movement or hear him say anything, then I was content to wait. They sent me out one cufflink. Then they came out and took him down the corridor to the operating room, and I just ran along behind the stretcher, not knowing what I was running to or what I was running from, but run I knew I must. And all during the surgery, which was 3.5 hours, I was in some little waiting room, and the doctors were just wonderful. They kept sending messages out to me to say that John would be all right, that the bullet had missed all the vital organs, and where he was in bad shape, he would be all right. And
thank you.
What else?
Governor, let me ask you the same question. What is your memory of the events? What did you see and hear? What happened after the limousine started down Elm Street and passed underneath the Texas School Book Depository?
Mr. Cornwell, we had just turned on Elm. We'd gone, I suspect, 150, 200 feet. When I heard what I thought was a rifle shot, and I thought it came from... I was seated right, as you know, on a jump seat right in front of the president, and they have a fairly straight back on them, so I was sitting up fairly erect. I thought the shot came from back over my right shoulder, so I turned
to see if I could catch a sight of the president out of the corner of my eye, because I immediately had the fear of an assassination, because I thought it was a rifle shot. I didn't think it was a blowout or an explosion of any kind. I didn't see the president out of the corner of my eye, so I was in the process of, at least I was thinking of turning, and I was turning to look over my left shoulder into the back seat to see if I could see him. I never looked, never made the full turn. About the time I turned back, where I was facing more or less straight ahead, the way the car was moving, I was hit. I was knocked over, just doubled over, by the force of the bullet. It went in my back and came out my chest, about 2 inches below and to the left of my right nipple, and the force of the bullet drove my body over almost double, and when I looked immediately, I could see I was just drenched with blood. So I knew I'd been badly hit. And I more or less straightened up. At about this time, Nellie reached over and pulled me down into her lap. And I was in her lap facing forward when another shot was fired. I only heard two shots. I did not hear the shot that hit me. I wasn't conscious of it. I'm sure I heard it, but I was not conscious of it at all. I heard another shot. I heard it hit. It hit with a very pronounced impact, all just almost like that, almost that loud a sound. It made a very, very strong sound, and immediately I could see blood and brain tissue all over the interior of the car and all over our clothes. We were both covered with brain tissue. There were pieces of brain tissue as big as your little finger. It was something that was unmistakable. There wasn't any question about, in my mind, about what it was. About this moment in time, Roy Kellerman, who was the Secret Service agent sitting in the right front seat, apparently was pushing some buttons on the panel, doing what, I don't know, but I heard him say, "Let's get out of here fast." And the car lurched forward then. Bill Greer was the driver, and he accelerated it tremendously. When I was hit, or shortly before I was hit, no, I guess it was after I was hit, I said first, just almost in despair, I said, "No, no, no, no." Thinking how tragic it was that we'd gone through this 24 hours that had all been so wonderful and so beautifully executed. The president had been so marvelously received, and then here at the last moment, this great tragedy. And I just said, "No, no, no, no." And then I said, right after I was hit, I said, "My God, they're going to kill us all." The shots came, in my judgment, the two shots I heard came from the same direction, back over my right shoulder, came from behind us. Very clear to me where they came from. I don't think any shots came from any other direction. I was conscious until we hit the Stemmons Freeway, and then I faded into unconsciousness. I revived when the car came to a stop at what was Parkland Hospital. Apparently, the braking of the car, we must have been traveling at an enormous rate of speed. The braking of the car brought me back to consciousness. And, you know, it's strange what thoughts run through your mind. The first thought that occurred to me was that I was in the jump seat, that the right door of the car was opposite my seat, and that they couldn't reach the president without I got out of the way. And that's when I tried to raise myself up out of Nellie's lap and actually to try to get out of the car myself so that they could get to him in the back seat, because I knew he'd been hit, and I knew that their first concern would be for the president. So that was the reason why I lurched up or tried to get up out of a reclining position, and of course I couldn't. I wasn't able to, and I got about halfway up and then just slumped again, as Nellie just told you. Then someone did pick me up and put me on a stretcher and took me into an emergency room or trauma room, whatever it was. I obviously didn't know what it was. At that point, I felt the first pain, really, that I had experienced. And when I was on the stretcher, I was laid out, and then there was excruciating pain in my chest. At the time I was hit, strangely enough, I felt no sharp pain. It was as if someone had come up behind me and with a doubled-up fist and just hit you in the back, right between the shoulder blades. It was that kind of a sensation. And I would have to volunteer the very, very strong opinion. I know much has been written, much has been discussed. I was being a participant. I can only give you my impressions. But I must say to you, as I said to the Warren Commission, I do not believe, nor will I ever believe, that I was hit with the first bullet. I don't believe it. I heard the shot. I heard the first shot. I reacted to the first shot. I was not hit with that bullet. Now, a great deal of speculation that the president and I were hit with the same bullet. That might well be, but it surely wasn't the first bullet. Nellie doesn't think it's the second bullet. I don't know. I didn't hear the second bullet. I felt the second bullet. We obviously weren't hit by the third bullet. I was down, reclining in her lap at the time the third bullet hit.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand one statement. You said that Mrs. Connolly doesn't agree it was the second bullet or the same bullet.
Second bullet.
The second bullet?
That what?
That hit me.
Yeah, what?
That hit, him and me.
No, I thought I heard three shots. I had three reactions, three separate reactions. First shot, and I looked and saw the president. Second shot, John. And the third, all this matter all over it.
So you agree that your recollection, it was the second shot that hit the governor?
I know it was the second shot that hit the governor.
And where you disagree as to the possibility or the question of whether or not it was the same bullet that hit. Is that accurate? In other words, the governor has no knowledge on that subject matter. Would that be accurate, that since you didn't turn around to see the president after the first noise, you don't know whether he was hit, and Mrs. Connolly's recollection is that she did turn and saw him hold his throat you were hit. Is that accurate?
That's mm-hmm. correct. I never saw him. I never saw Miss Kennedy after the shots were fired. I never saw either one of them.
All right.
And I don't know when he was hit.
And you've testified that of the two shots that you have a memory of hearing, your immediate impression was they came from the right rear?
That's correct.
And I don't believe we heard what Mrs. Connolly's recollection is on that. What was your impression as to the direction from which the three shots you heard came?
All from the right rear.
Mr. Chairman, I have no further questions at this time.
This time the chair will recognize a gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Devine, for extensive questioning, after which the committee will go under the five-minute rule for other members of the committee who have questions of the witnesses. Mr. Devine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Governor Muscali, I know this is very difficult for you to have to relive this situation again and again. I know that you, Governor, testified before the Warren Commission, and I'm not sure whether you did also. And we appreciate the fact that we're trying to refresh your recollection on something that happened nearly 15 years ago. Although it appears to be quite vivid in your mind, and the responsibility of this committee, as you know, on mandate from the House, is to see whether or not there are any unturned stones or any evidence that has not been presented to the Warren Commission, or that any different conclusions may result from the testimony of persons on the scene. Relating specifically to your testimony, Mrs. Connolly, you heard one shot and you turned to your right and witnessed the president grasping his throat with both hands. Was anything said by anyone at that time?
Nothing.
Then what is the next sound you heard? You were still looking back at the president. Did you hear another sound?
I heard the second shot. Yes.
Second shot. Were you looking back at that time, or were you looking forward again?
I don't know.
Don't recall. That second shot is the one that you said hit your husband?
I was horror-stricken when I looked back, and I may have still been just looking.
But at that time you heard a second shot.
Very difficult thing to believe.
The second shot that you heard is the one you believe hit Governor Connolly?
I know it hit Governor Connolly.
And then after you knew that he was hit and you pull him over in your lap, you then heard the third shot?
Yes.
And again from over your right shoulder?
Yes.
Did you look back at that time?
I never looked back after John was hit.
Have you had any experience at all with firearms?
Yes.
Over the years? Would you say in your judgment that the shot that you heard or the shots that you heard were from a rifle or a handgun?
Oh, no, I'm not that much of a...
You don't know, but...
And I'm not expert at all.
All right.
Shooting.
Governor, I think you testified that you heard but two shots and that you don't think that you heard the shot that struck you. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
And both of these came from over your right shoulder?
Yes, sir. From behind me and over my back behind me over my right shoulder. That's correct.
The first shot that you heard, which caused you to look to your right, I think you said you didn't get far enough around to see the president. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
Did you recognize the sound as being a rifle shot or a handgun shot?
I thought it was a rifle shot.
And then you turned around and started to turn around to look over your left shoulder to see what?
See if the president was all right, because the thought flashed through my mind that if this was a rifle shot, which I believed it to be, that it was probably an assassination attempt, and I was trying to see if anything had happened in the automobile.
Was that the time that you exclaimed no, 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 or was it later?
No, it was a bit later, because I wasn't sure at that point in time that anything had happened. So it was a bit later when I said, oh, no, no, no. This was after I realized I'd been hit. And then I said, my God, they're going to kill us all.
But as you turn from looking over your right shoulder, you're about facing forward in the process of turning to look over your left shoulder when you were hit.
Yes, sir.
But you heard no shot that
no,
hit
sir.
You.
No, sir, I did not.
And that caused you to lean forward?
Yes, sir.
And you said you saw a great deal of blood?
Yes, sir.
Were you aware at that time that you were hit in the hand and leg also?
No, sir, I was not.
And when did you first become aware of that, in the emergency room or else?
I became aware of that when I regained consciousness
On Sunday, I guess. Sunday morning, I woke up and regained consciousness to see my arm tied up in a sling and my leg bandaged, and I said, you know, what happened to my arm? And that's when I first learned that the bullet had gone through my chest and through my wrist and had broken all the bones in my wrist.
Reflecting back, do you have an opinion that you would have been able to physically remove your body from your position on the jump seat to a different position in the limousine during the time lapse between the first sound and the impact that hit you?
I'm sorry, Congressman, you might
have... To put it this way, I think either you or Mrs. Connolly said that the jump seats were so close to the back of the front seat that there was no way that you could have slumped to the floor.
Right.
And that the only position you could have ultimately moved into was to be over on Mrs. Connolly's lap. Is that accurate?
That, I think that's a correct statement.
I believe you testified in response to Mr. Cornwell that you heard only two shots. They came from behind, and there was not any from any other direction. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
Mrs. Connolly, would you also make the same statement?
Except that I heard all three.
Is it possible that there could have been more than three shots, as far as your recollection is concerned?
I guess anything's possible,
yes.
But I heard three shots.
You heard three, definitely, no less, and probably no more. Is that right?
That's all I heard.
And Governor Connolly, you said that you heard two shots.
That's
the one that hit you, you apparently did not hear.
That's correct.
I would take it then by a negative implication that you heard no shots coming from your right front.
No, sir, I did not.
In the area that has often been described as the grassy knoll.
No, sir. And I don't believe any came from there.
We responded to all these shots. So if something came from the front, we certainly would have responded to a noise from the front. I would think.
All right, now getting back prior to the time of the actual shooting, I think you indicated earlier, Governor, that you had been in, or your people had been in somewhat of a dispute with Mr. Bruno and others relative to even having a motorcade.
Yes, sir. And may I, Congressman Devine, at that point ask that the record be corrected in testifying here. You reach for times and events and names, and unfortunately I have confused the situation, I suspect, to the bewilderment of one and the embarrassment of the other, and I said, Mr. Hal Bruno. Mr. Hal Bruno is with Newsweek, and now I'm standing with ABC, and it wasn't Hal Bruno at all. It was Jerry Bruno, who came down as an advanced man for President Kennedy. So I would hope the record would be clarified and corrected, because earlier I testified in response to Mr. Cornwell that Mr. Hal Bruno did so-and-so. It was not Mr. Hal Bruno. It was Mr. Jerry Bruno.
Fine. Well, I'm sure the record will be so corrected. Governor, I think you testified earlier that you thought perhaps it would be well to avoid the motorcade because of the very trying day that the president was going through, the number of appearances he had to make, the number of speeches he had to make, and the pressures. Did you have any reason to believe that there might have been some incident on a motorcade route?
Was that not at all, Congressman Devine, none at all.
You had no...
No.
Prior information that would suggest that there may have been problems?
None at all.
I think that there was some testimony that there were some, I don't think they used the word kooks, but some extremists that perhaps might display signs or make remarks that might be embarrassing to the president.
Well, that, when I said not at all, I was speaking in terms of, I had no indication, no knowledge, no reason to suspect that there would be any acts of violence. I assumed from the very beginning that when the president came, that somewhere along the route, San Antonio, Houston, Fort Worth, Dallas, Austin, somewhere, That there might be pickets, there might be some embarrassing signs or something of that kind. Yes, I did assume that we would encounter that. And frankly, we encountered only one that I remember, and that's far less than I anticipated. Mm-hmm.
I suppose you were also, at least in the back of your mind, aware of the incident that had occurred to Ambassador Stevenson,
yes,
as well,
sir,
as General Walker?
Yes, sir.
And these were matters of concern to you, but you still had no anticipation that anything of violence might occur. Is that correct?
No, sir. And my objection to the motorcade really was not based on any apprehension of violence, Congressman Devine, at all. It was, as I testified, merely in order to try to save the president the wear and tear of a motorcade and to basically conserve time.
At any juncture during the planning and scheduling, did you specifically discuss with the Secret Service what possible harm might come to the president, and if so, from what source? Either you or your people.
Congressman, I don't think so. I don't know. Some of the some of our people might have raised that point with the Secret Service, but I doubt it, because in none of our discussions our planning sessions did we dwell on that subject or make any point of it. It really was not a matter that we were fearful of, frankly.
But if you had had your way, there would have been no motorcade through the downtown area. You would have gone directly to the...
Trademark,
right?
Correct. As a matter of fact, it was quite a point of dispute, as I say, and we never did agree to it. And finally, they not only said we're going to have a motorcade, but we're going to publish the route of it. And I said, well, that's crazy. And I said, because here again, but I was thinking only in terms of pickets or embarrassing signs or things of that sort.
Yeah.
But indeed they did. They ran a map of the parade route 3 or 4 days, I think it was Tuesday before the Friday, in the Dallas papers.
Well,
full route of the motorcade.
Did the newspaper publish the exact route of the motorcade?
I think it did. They might have altered the route a bit from that published map, but I think it was the map, precise map of the motorcade.
And that was published in sufficient time for someone with perhaps sinister motive to have placed themselves in the book depository or elsewhere.
I think it was published on Tuesday, and of course the event occurred on Friday, so they had that much time.
Well, Mr. Cornwell has pretty well covered all other elements of the situation, Governor, and I, again, thank you for your cooperation, and you, Mrs. Connell, for being here.
Thank you, Congressman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Pryor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
This is Richardson Pryor, who is chairman of the Kennedy Subcommittee.
No, as Mr. Devine said, that reliving this experience must be an emotional matter for you, and all who have watched you cannot help but admire your courage and the way you've done that. I don't know what the stories are that you referred to, Mrs. Connolly, about your conduct after this, but anyone who heard you today certainly could have no questions about your courage and the character with which you faced this. I also think you brought back to us in a dramatic way the warmth and excitement of the Dallas reception, something that we've lost sight of through the years because of the way it ended in tragedy. I only had one question following up what Mr. Devine asked, and it's along the line of what information and how early the information would have been known as to the president's route. Lee Harvey Oswald went to work for the Dallas Book Depository on October the 15th. 1963. How soon after that, if you recall, Governor Connally, would he have known that the president was coming to Dallas?
He could have known it before that time, I suspect. I believe the time of the publication of the Baskin story in the Dallas paper was September the 26th, when the story first appeared, that November 21st and 22nd had been chosen as the dates of the president's visit.
So he would have known he was coming to Dallas, perhaps even earlier than his employment date. But he would not have known the parade route until Tuesday?
I don't think he could have, Congressman Pryor, because up until the very last, frankly, of that week, we were still arguing about it. We were still arguing, one, whether or not there'd be a motorcade at all. Two, if there was a motorcade, whether or not the route of the motorcade would be published. And frankly, those who were proponents of the motorcade and of the route wanted to get the maximum public exposure for the president, and that was the basic reason for the motorcade. But that issue was not settled until that week, the week of the visit. So I'm sure that he couldn't have known precisely prior to that time, because I don't think anyone knew.
Well, from your experience in Texas and national politics, wasn't that the normal parade route through Dallas that was taken? Have you been involved in other parades?
Yes, it's a normal and a logical route to take down Lemon to Turtle Creek, and down, you could go down either Main or Commerce, depending on what your ultimate destination was. But since we were going to the trademark, it was a logical way to go, although we could have chosen one of the other streets that runs parallel to Main and Commerce just as well. But probably we saw more people on the streets that we traveled.
Well, thank you once again for your testimony.
Thank you, Congressman Pryor.
The time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from the District of Columbia, Mr. Fauntroy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you also, Governor and Mrs. Connally. We do so appreciate your recalling the events in Dallas with such great detail. I simply have a couple of questions dealing with the timing of the publication of the trip. Who knew what and when? And I wondered, Governor Connally, if you would could tell us who would have been aware of your talks with the president on June the 5th in El Paso.
Well, initially, I would say there were only four of us, maybe five. The president, the vice president was there. As I recall, well, I'm sure Kenny O'Donnell was there. I was there. Now, after that time, I'm sure they talked it at the White House. I'm sure the vice president talked to members of his staff about it. I certainly went home and talked to various members of my staff and the state Democratic Party machinery, because we were at that point in effect committed to a presidential visit sometime that fall, but the details certainly were not known then.
Did you recall that you released publicity at that time about the president's desire to come to Texas?
I don't believe there was any, but I could be wrong about that. I don't recall any.
And you set no tentative schedule?
No.
At that time, huh? Was there any information at that time that a motorcade would or would not be used?
No, I don't think so, Congressman, no.
Mm-hmm. Was Dallas listed as one of the cities that might be visited? Do you recall?
I think from the very outset, from the time of the first announcement, which I don't think occurred that early, I think Dallas was listed as one of the cities, yes.
Mm-hmm.
As probably one of the cities that would be visited.
You had a visit to the White House on October the 4th, you recall?
Yes, sir.
You recall now how much information had been disclosed to the public by that time?
I think very little, because it hadn't gelled really at that point. The details had not been worked out at that point.
You met with members of the Texas delegation on October the 3rd to the Congress here, and do you recall what details about the presidential visit were discussed with them?
No, I don't, but I suspect no details other than the fact that there probably was going to be a presidential visit, because when I went in on the October the 4th, really the president was still talking about four or five fundraising dinners, and we really had not made the ultimate decisions that about the visit.
Mr. Chairman, I think I want to thank the gentleman and Mrs. Connolly, and I'll yield back the balance of my time at this time.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Connecticut, Mr. McKinney.
Governor, nice to see you again. I want to thank both you and Mrs. Connolly for coming and helping us. When was the final decision made that you, or I guess, when did you finally get your way that the speech would be made at the Trademark instead of at the Women's Building?
I don't remember, Congressman, the precise date, but I would guess it was a couple of weeks before the visit.
Basically, that was a decision on your part to, so that the president could woo back the conservative faction of the party in Texas?
Yeah, well, basically, the Women's Building is in the fairgrounds part of the city. The Trademark at that time was a new, exciting building out on the Stemmons Freeway. It's a magnificent facility. It's a beautiful facility. I thought it was the type of thing that that particularly reflected the flair and the style of both President and Mrs. Kennedy. It was a new building. It's a tremendous thing with an enormous vaulted ceiling. The Secret Service had some doubts about it because it had balconies around, but we filled all those balconies with tables, and it was just a better facility, better parking, easier to get to for everybody because you get to it right off the Stemmons Freeway. And I thought it just frankly was a much better facility in order to accommodate the crowd that we wanted to have, 1,800, 2,000 people there to hear the president. I didn't go at the time. There was a big argument about whether we go to the Women's Building or the Trademark. I didn't go to either one of them at the time. Most of these arguments arose at the staff level, and then those that they couldn't settle, I'd finally hear about and get a hold of, and sometimes I'd just make a decision we were going to do thus and so, and sometimes I'd call somebody at the White House and get it worked out, but this went on constantly.
In any event, at either building, the motorcade would have had to go through some part of Dealey Plaza.
In any event, the motorcade certainly would have gone through downtown. It would not necessarily have had to go through Dealey Plaza. No, sir. If the Women's Building had been chosen, it could have gone another route, and probably would have gone another route.
Going through Dealey Plaza, if you had gone through Dealey Plaza to the Women's Building, the Mrs. Kennedy would have been literally in the line of fire rather than the president, wouldn't she?
Yes, if you'd gone by the school book depository. That's correct.
Thank you very much, Governor.
Time for the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Connecticut, Mr. Dodd.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Governor, Mrs. Connolly, to repeat what my colleagues have said, we do appreciate your being here this morning, particularly in recounting what must have been one of the most agonizing, if not the most agonizing, moments of your lives. I'd like to just go back over, if I could, those seconds that occur at the time that the shots rang out. And let me try and repeat what I understood to be your testimony. And you correct me if I'm wrong anywhere in terms of my understanding of the sequence of events as they occurred. First you, Mrs. Connolly, if I can, because there is a bit of a difference as I heard both of your responses. You heard a shot, or what appeared or sounded like a shot, a sharp noise to you. You turned to your left or your right?
My right.
You turned to your right. And as you turned around and saw the president, you saw him clutching his throat.
I saw him reach up to his throat.
Both hands were on his throat. Did you see any blood at all?
No.
You then, did you turn back or did you hear the second shot?
See, I don't know. I don't know.
You don't know which you did first.
What do you mean?
Well, you saw him
clutch. I looked back, and I guess I just stayed looking back until I heard the second shot.
So the second, you're still looking at the president, and it's your recollection that you then heard what sounded like a second shot. Is that correct?
Yes. What was the second shot?
And at that point, your husband, Governor Connally, slumped over in your direction.
No. He lunged forward and then just kind of collapsed.
And then collapsed.
But not just straight up.
And then you heard a third shot, or what appeared to be a third shot.
After I pulled him down.
But you did hear what
I did hear a third shot.
A third shot. And at that point, you then noticed the material, the...
All over.
The blood and so forth.
Yeah.
When you turned and saw the president holding his throat, as I understood your testimony, the president didn't utter any sound or any word at all to your recollection?
Nothing.
Now, Governor, as I understood it from what your testimony was, you heard what sounded like a shot.
That's correct.
And you turned to your...
Right.
Your right. But you did not see the president when you turned around.
That's correct. I didn't turn all the way around. I was sitting basically facing forward. I heard the shot. I looked over my right shoulder. I did not see the president out of the corner of my eye. And I mentally said, I'll turn to my left and see if I can see him. And I had never made that full turn. I got halfway back, facing forward, when I was hit.
And did I understand your testimony correctly when you stated that you didn't actually hear a second shot, but rather you felt the impact as if someone had punched you almost in the back, a sharp blow to your back?
That is absolutely correct.
But you did not hear that?
I was not conscious of hearing the second shot.
WFCR Amherst.
Did you hear what could have been a second or a third shot? That was the only shot you heard, was the one that caused you to turn to your right.
No, I heard another shot, which was a shot that was fired after Nellie had pulled me down into her lap. It was the second shot I heard, the third shot she heard.
Okay.
The second shot I heard was the one that hit the president in the head.
Okay. Now, do you... You did not immediately go unconscious.
No, I did not. I heard, I knew exactly what was happening in the car, and I didn't testify to it a moment ago, but I should, because I remember precisely what my wife remembers. I heard Miss Kennedy say, they have killed my husband. And then she said, in incredulous voice, I've got his brains in my hand. I heard that. I was still conscious. I heard Roy Kellerman say to Bill Greer, the driver, and perhaps to others, get out of here fast. Those things, and that's all that was said in that car.
Recognizing, of course, now we're asking you to recall something that occurred this many years ago. But if I could ask you to quantify in a frame of time, how long a period would it have been between the time you heard that first noise, it sounded to you as if it were a shot, you turned right, and the period in which you felt the impact in your back?
Congressman, I think it's impossible for me to say with precision, but obviously a very short period of time, a matter of seconds. Because I was in the, it was, I think, undoubtedly a fairly fluid movement. I heard the shot. I reacted by looking.
I saw nothing, and I was in the process of turning when I felt the impact. I guess, you know, 6, 8, 10 seconds in that range, but I certainly couldn't be more precise than that. But it wasn't long.
Could it have been a second? What you're telling me is it's more like 2, 3, 4 seconds. It wasn't something that happened almost instantaneously.
No, it wasn't. No, it was not. Could not have been 1 second.
Thank you both. Mr. Chairman, I have no further questions.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Fethian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Governor Ms. Connolly, a welcome, and under the circumstances, we deeply appreciate your help. Governor, the two shots that you heard, did they sound exactly alike, as nearly as you can remember?
Did they sound exactly?
Exactly alike.
Yes, I remember no distinction, Congressman Fethian, between the two shots.
And the shot that struck you, just in that split second before you heard that or felt that impact, did you hear any other impact like the third shot made? Was there any just split-second impact somewhere else before it hit you?
No.
Now, if I understand your summary, Mrs. Connolly, the first shot would have come through the president's throat, and that was, you said you were...
I assume I saw him.
Right. And it was the second shot that hit the governor. And it wasn't until after the third shot that you saw the brain matter and
but
so forth.
But instantly the shot, the car was covered. It was like buckshot falling all over us.
So your clear recollection is that you can account for something happening with each of the three shots that
yes,
you
sir.
Heard fired.
Yes, sir.
Governor, you testified earlier, I believe, that you thought that both shots fired were rifle shots. You feel that you would be able to distinguish between a rifle and a pistol shot?
I guess you could simulate circumstances under which I'd probably fail the test, Congressman, but I think I can distinguish the difference. At least at that point in time, I thought it was a rifle shot. To me, and I haven't... In all the intervening years, I've not run any tests, I've not listened to any tests, but to me, a pistol shot has a flatter, louder, kind of a bang type of sound to it. A rifle shot has a rather singing crack to it. It's more like a crack, and then you get a kind of a singing sound with a rifle shot. And it's an entirely different sound from a pistol, from a shotgun, and from a rifle.
One last question, Mr. Chairman. When you heard any of the two shots that you heard, Governor, or any of the three that you heard, Mrs. Connolly, is there any echo? Did you hear any echo from the building, or was there any sort of a sound effect along with it? Just heard the shot.
Congressman, I wasn't conscious of any echoes. I'm sure there probably were some, but I certainly was not aware of them.
But what you heard was just a very clear, distinct shot,
yes,
period. That's your recollection.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Sawyer.
Yes, Governor and Mr. Connolly, I recognize that you probably don't view yourself as a ballistics expert by any means, but I assume you've done some hunting and are familiar with firearms from the way you talk.
Yes, sir. I've done a great deal.
So that we're not talking to someone totally inexperienced when we're talking about whether or not you can identify a rifle shot.
No, sir. I've shot a rifle all my life and I've done a great deal of hunting and...
I suppose, too, that, I've just been thinking about this since I heard your testimony, and I'm sure you've thought about it many, many more times. And without either being a medical expert or a ballistic expert, I presume it's reasonable to assume that with a Mannlicher Carcano traveling at least twice the speed of sound, the projectile must be at least 2,200 feet per second or more, I assume.
Yes, sir.
that the bullet would reach you before the sound would reach you, and with that kind of an impact on your nervous system, whether conscious or not, you probably wouldn't have registered the sound if there was one of the bullet that hit you.
I think that's precisely what happened, Congressman, no question about it. That's why I don't think there's any way that the first bullet hit me. I heard that sound, and I had not been hit. I heard that first rifle shot, and I did not hear, I was not conscious of the shot that hit me. And obviously, the bullet reached me before the sound did. And so in the shock of the hit that I took, I was just totally unconscious of the sound. And yet by the third shot, when Miss Conley pulled me down in her lap, I was awake, my eyes were open, I heard the shot fired, I heard it hit, and I saw the results very clearly. Now, you know, you'll have a lot of expert testimony, and I'm delighted at the work of this committee, because hopefully we can cure up some of the speculation and the questions that have been asked over the years. But let me assure you that we may be wrong in what we say. We may be wrong in our impressions. We may be wrong when we ask precise questions about time, whether it's 2 seconds or 10 seconds. Under those circumstances, I can't say with certainty the precise second that things happen. But the things that we do remember and the things that we're testifying to here today, Congressman, are as indelibly etched in our minds as anything could ever be. And I will merely ask you to give yourselves the test. Ask any adult person over the age of 30 in this country, or over the age of 35, we'll say, where they were when they first heard the news of the assassination. They can tell you where they were, what they were doing, and who they were with. I've not asked one human being in the world, not anywhere in the world, that hadn't been able to tell me where they were, what they were doing, and who they were with at the time they first heard the news. The only point I'm making is that there are certain impacts on human consciousness and on the human mind that are indelibly etched there. Now, and these things are engraven in our minds, beyond any doubt. I'm not going to argue with a ballistics expert or acoustics expert about the precise time or the frame of the Zapruder films. I can't tell you precisely whether it's frame 231 or 234 when the first evidence shows that I'm reacting to the shot. But what we are saying to you, the things that we say to you with certain definiteness, it is because we are absolutely sure, at least in our own minds, that that's what happened and that's what we remember.
Well, I want to join the rest of my colleagues in expressing our appreciation for you, Governor, and Mrs. Connolly coming up. And I want to just compliment you on the obvious frankness, touched with a little humor as best you can, this kind of a situation, and your warmth coming across. I appreciate it very much. And it kind of gave me a perspective on this that perhaps only someone that was there could really get, but you've certainly gotten across about as good a communication of it, at least to me, as I've had. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Edgar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Governor and Mrs. Conley, I too want to welcome you here and to compliment you on your frankness and sharing your firsthand knowledge of this tragic event. I just have two lines of questioning, which will be very brief. I noted in the schedule that on November 21st, there was a motorcade through Houston. Is that correct?
Well, it was a motorcade, yes, in a sense. We went from the airport, Hobby Airport, where the plane landed, down the Gulf Freeway to downtown Houston. And we had, as I say, we'd rather planned it this way because it was a way to automatically assure yourself of the crowd.
Were the crowds similar in Houston as they were in Dallas?
No. No, they were not, because it was not the same type of event, and we didn't plan a motorcade of that type. What occurred in Houston was that we were going against the grain of the traffic. The Gulf Freeway was 4 lanes wide, bumper to bumper, leaving Houston, going out past Hobby Airport toward on the Gulf Freeway. We were going into town, so there were literally thousands of cars on that freeway.
And all the traffic just stopped when they saw this motorcade. They knew who it was. They knew the president was coming. So people were standing on their fenders. If they had fenders, if not, they opened the doors to the inside of the car. They were in the pickups. They were shouting and waving and that sort of thing. But there was not the mass number of people that we saw at either San Antonio or Dallas.
And the speed of the motorcade was different?
Was entirely different. I would say in Houston we were traveling at least, probably 50 miles an hour.
The motorcade in Dallas on the 22nd was for a slightly different purpose. It was not just to arouse the crowd, but was in fact to be worked by the president in a slow-moving motorcade.
That's correct.
Were the automobiles in both motorcades identical?
I think so. I think the president's car was flown from one place to the other. I think we were riding in the same car.
Do you know if the president's car was equipped with any kind of facility to have visual sighting of the president, even with the top down?
Yes, I think we had a bubble top, but it was never used.
And do you know whose decision it was not to use the bubble top?
No, sir.
Probably.
And the bubble top was not used in Houston either?
No, sir.
Were there any different security procedures that you know of for the Dallas motorcade?
I don't think so, Congressman. If there were any, there were probably more people involved simply because of the nature of the visit to Dallas. We were going to have the motorcade. It was going to be a motorcade where we were traveling at 25 miles an hour. As opposed to 50 miles an hour on the Gulf Freeway in Houston, for instance. So I think there were a great many more people, security people, involved up and down the parade route in Dallas than there were in Houston. But that's a normal thing. I don't think it was unusual because of any anticipated difficulties.
But you weren't approached by the Secret Service to do anything special?
No. No, the Secret Service were working with the Department of Public Safety and the Dallas Police Department. And I don't recall any real difficulties with respect to security.
Thank you. Just one final question. I was wondering about the injuries that you received, the shot through the right shoulder and the wrist injury and the leg injury. Are they recurring problems for you at this time?
No, sir. The shoulder injury, the back injury, was healed fairly well. The bullet split my right lung, and as I recall, the doctor told me like it'd been cut with a knife. It took out, I believe, the fifth and sixth ribs of the. But I learned something new. The ribs grew back, which I didn't realize they would do. So the only thing I've had over the years, and it's my fault, not any medical problem, my right shoulder and arm has been a bit weaker than the left, simply because I think I didn't do enough exercising with it after the injury to rebuild the muscles, and I think at least one muscle was cut in the process of either the shot or the operation. The wrist is fine. Dr. Gregory, when he set the wrist, told me that he thought it would not heal properly because he had no bone in which to tie to, and that he would do his best, that we'd probably have to re-break the wrist and reset it after some of the bones heal because it broke every bone in the wrist. But after about 90 days, when they finally took the cast off, the wrist had healed sufficiently to where we weren't about to break that wrist. And I have substantially all the use of it. The only thing I can't do is to turn my wrist over.
He can't take change, but I can pick it up for him.
And it's strange that little things like that, this is where you recognize it. To take change, I have to do this kind of a thing to flatten my hand, because normally you can hold your elbow on the table and flip your hand over. I just can't do that. There's a stiffness in the wrist, but there's no pain associated with it. No disability at all, and the leg has caused me no trouble ever. It was so I'm in fine shape.
There's absolutely no doubt in your mind that all of the injuries that occurred to you occurred by one bullet passing through your body.
I have no reason to think otherwise. I think it beyond any question it did. And Congressman, that probably I should add in response to your question that One of the reasons I may have had the wrist injury, I had a hat that day. And sometimes I had the hat on and sometimes I didn't. And when I didn't have it on, I was holding the thing. And of course, the president never wore one. And when I held it, I normally held it in pretty much this position. I just held it in front of me. And I suspect that one or two things happened, and I don't remember precisely, that I was either holding my hat so that when that bullet came out of my chest, right here, went right into my arm and then down into my leg, or that's one explanation of why my wrist was broken. Or in the process of turning, perhaps I had put my right arm on my left leg to make the turn to my left, as I testified. I would not have done that to look over my right shoulder. It would have been the reverse type of move. My right arm would have been to my right, looking over my right shoulder. But in the process of turning to look over my left shoulder, it's a logical thing to move your arm. And maybe I put it on my wrist. Maybe I had my hat in my hand. But in any event, the wrist happened to be right in front of the place where the bullet came out.
Thank you. I have no further questions, Mr. Chairman.
The time for the gentleman has expired. Chair recognizes the gentleman from District of Columbia, Mr. Fauntroy, for additional questions.
Yes, Chairman, thank you. I just have one question on the firing. And that is, you are both familiar with the single bullet theory. My question, Governor Connolly, is, given Mrs. Connolly's recollection that there were three shots, one, the first of which hit the president, the second of which hit you, and the third of which hit the president, I wonder if it is your impression that the first shot that you heard missed, or whether it is your impression that first shot which you heard was the first shot which Mrs. Connolly heard, which it is her impression caused the president to grab his throat.
You want to answer that?
No.
Well,
no, I'll
answer it. I think it's, I don't know what the first shot did. All I know, all I'm certain of in my own mind is that the first shot did not hit me. Mm-hmm. Now, according to Ms. Connolly's testimony, the first shot did hit the president. And that's when she turned around and saw him grasp his throat.
And later, the doctor said that there was a bullet that went through the fleshy part of his neck that would not have killed the president had that been the only shot he took. So obviously, that's why he was reaching up for his throat.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Connolly.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Fethian.
When you turned, Mrs. Connolly, and saw the president, do you remember seeing the governor, seeing where he was looking?
No, I heard the noise. I turned in the direction of the noise, and I observed the president, and I was horrified.
Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Mr. Cornwall, anything further? Governor Connolly and Mrs. Connolly, under the rules of our committee, any witness appearing before our committee and giving testimony is to be extended 5 minutes at the conclusion of their testimony for the purpose of explaining or in any way amplifying or expanding upon their testimony before this committee. I wish to extend to both of you at this time 5 minutes in order to make any further comments that you so desire.
You want to make
it? You think we ought to talk about the kind of wound and have any birthday
saved
your life?
No, I think
I have nothing.
Mr. Chairman, let me, for both of us, express our gratitude to you, Chairman Stokes, to all the members of the committee, to the staff of the committee, for what has been an obvious workmanlike approach that the staff has used in trying to develop all of the facts relating to this tragic event in the life of this nation. Unfortunately, I think for the peace of mind of a great many people,
Much speculation has arisen. Many rumors have flowed. Many theories have been advanced. This committee is going to be faced, I think, with the same task that the Warren Commission was faced with. Namely, how do you prove a negative? How do you prove there was no conspiracy? I think that's the task that you have, but you've assembled a staff of obviously competent people of with a determination to try to adduce all of the evidence that's available in the world, to properly analyze it, and to properly present it. And to that extent, I think the committee is undertaking a task which I'm fearful will not answer all the problems, but nevertheless, your report will undoubtedly shed a great deal of light on a tragedy that this nation had and that this nation will live with. I wish I could believe that all of the speculation will end, that all the answers will be given, and all the rumors dispelled, and all the theories dissipated, but I don't believe that. And it won't be the fault of the staff nor the fault of this committee. I think it'll be a mere result of circumstances that are incapable of proof. But for your effort, for your time, for your obvious dedication, we're grateful because we have obviously been a part of this event, and we will always be a part of it. And so the more that the American people can understand, I think the better the nation is. I would make one other comment, Mr. Chairman, that is a gratuitous comment that I hope is not inappropriate at this moment. Part of your task is to analyze the effectiveness of the Secret Service, the FBI, the other police agencies, and in the furtherance of their duties with respect to this tragic occurrence. As Secretary of the Treasury, as you know, I had jurisdiction over the Secret Service. On many occasions, I talked to them about the problem of personal security of a president, of visiting dignitaries, and others. I happen to be of the view that if, very much as your chief counsel, Mr. Blakey, said of President Kennedy, that if there is a determined assassin, that beyond any question, he can be successful. I don't think there's enough protection that any man in public life is going to surround himself with that will preclude a determined assassin from carrying out his mission. I can only say to you that I think the Secret Service was a determined and a dedicated group to protecting the life of the president, and unfortunately, they failed. Senator Kennedy had security, but they were unable to cope with his assassin. President Ford, if you will recall, also had security, a great amount of security, but they probably would have failed too if the young lady had known how to use a gun. So that finally, I'm simply saying to you that I don't know that any political figure in this country can be spared an assassin's bullet if indeed there is a dedicated assassin. So I would hope that the American people would understand that the mere fact that the Secret Service failed was not a failure of desire, not a failure of dedication, not a failure of talent, but rather a failure of inevitable circumstances. Finally, again, let me express for Ms. Connelly and myself our appreciation for your kindness and for your courtesy and for the tremendous task that you've undertaken. Thank you very much.
Governor, I just say to both you and to Mrs. Connelly, on behalf of this committee and the House of Representatives, we are indeed grateful to you for having appeared here today. Both of you in a very articulate way have made a contribution to our work for which we are indeed grateful. We thank you for having been here again. Thank you very much. Your excuse.